Hello, everyone, and welcome to an overview of climate change for K-8 educators with a focus on assessment webcast. My name is Sadhana Sivasubramaniam, and I'm very excited to facilitate this webcast. Today's webcast is a brief introduction of how to integrate the topic of climate change into your classroom. This session will introduce climate change, followed by an overview of some of the potential sources, impacts, and possible solutions for this crisis. Along with this overview, I will be illustrating assessments for and as learning in this webcast in order to provide you with creative options that you can eventually implement in your classrooms. I hope you enjoy this webcast and can take back some of the ideas and strategies presented in this session to your classroom and students. But before we get started, I would first like to read the ETO's land acknowledgement. In the spirit of truth and reconciliation, the Elementary Teachers Federation of Ontario acknowledges that we are gathered today on the customary and traditional lands of the Indigenous peoples of this territory. Here's my agenda for today's webcast. As you can see, my agenda follows a typical pattern of what an educator would use when creating a unit for their class. This was done intentionally to share my own planning process when creating a unit on climate change for my classroom. Several Ontario curriculum subject documents include climate change as a topic that can be integrated to create cross-curricular learning. Some of the curriculum documents that I reference when planning are the Environmental Education Scope and Sequence, Growing Success, the Science and Technology Curriculum Grades 1 to 8 that was revised in 2022. On page 85 of the 2022 Science and Technology Curriculum, it states, climate change is an important topic addressed in age-appropriate learning throughout the strands of the science and technology curriculum. While climate change concepts and discussions address important environmental concerns, it is important to also foster hope and optimism in teaching and learning about climate change and other environmental issues. Students will develop the skills and knowledge needed to understand the causes and potential innovative solutions and mitigating strategies related to climate change and other environmental issues, and how they can make the most environmentally responsible decisions possible given the choices they have. You will notice that throughout this webcast, an icon will appear when curriculum expectations are referred to. In my classroom, I will begin any unit with a diagnostic assessment. This is an assessment an educator uses when their students to figure out what students know with respect to a topic or content. In other words, a diagnostic assessment allows educators to analyze what prior knowledge students already have. In this case, it would be analyzing what prior knowledge your students have with regards to climate change. The information from the diagnostic assessment will inform the educator on what content will need to be included in the introductory lesson regarding climate change. After an introduction of the content, students will be provided opportunities for deeper investigations of potential sources, impacts, and possible solutions for climate change. As part of the assessment learning cycle, educators will continue to gather and analyze assessment for learning to provide descriptive feedback to students and plan next steps for their students' learning. Educators need to do this so that they know if their students are building their knowledge regarding climate change. In this webcast, I will continue to model how to assess students for their purpose of improving their learning. Remember, you know your students well. When creating your unit plans and assessments, remember to incorporate differentiated instruction and universal design for learning. Create tasks that cater to the needs, interests, and skills of your students. Assessments can be innovative and collaborative. As you will see in my webcast, there are many ways to assess your students that are fun and enjoyable for your students as well as yourself. I also wanted to discuss with all of you on how we should select and evaluate different types of sources. In this webcast, you will notice that I use several sources to provide you with information on climate change. It is important that we use reliable, current, accurate references during our classroom discussions with our students. So near the end of this session, I'll introduce you to something called the CRAAP test. I will go over what this test is all about, and hopefully you will be able to use this in your classrooms as well. So, let's get started. As mentioned before, as an educator, you need to assess your students' previous knowledge about a topic. In this case, climate change. Diagnostic assessments should not be graded or included in report cards. It is essential that students understand that the purpose of diagnostic assessments is to create next steps for their learning. Otherwise, some may become worried that their report card marks will be affected, especially if they lack prior knowledge. There are many types of diagnostic assessments that you can do. One example is the creation of a KWL chart. However, since most students love using technology, I wanted to incorporate that in this assessment. There are many applications that can be used. One free application that I enjoy using is Mentimeter.com. As always, please check the application usage policy in your district school board. This tool allows members to ask students a question, and their students can respond using this online tool. Mentimeter allows the member to create interactive slides that instantly display student responses in the form of multiple choice, word clouds, or ranking scales. Once the slides are created, the Mentimeter application provides a code that students enter upon going to the menti.com website. This application can be screened using a project so that students can see the results displayed in real time. I really enjoy using this application as it allows students to participate and become engaged in the assigned task instead of avoiding and not participating at all. As you can see, Mentimeter also allows members to do follow-ups. In other words, you can share and export your results for further analysis and even compare data over time to measure the progress of your audience. As you can see, I asked my students the following question. What do you know about climate change? I designed it in a way where each of my students would be able to provide three responses to this question. I also said that they could use words, phrases, or sentences to let me know what they're thinking. I wanted their responses to be displayed in a word cloud. As you can see on this slide, their responses come in different colors and sizes. The bigger the size of the text, the more popular the response is from the audience. In this case, the word global warming was the most common response. On the bottom of the slide, you can see how many people participated in this task. In this particular example, 12 students responded. And on the top of the slide, you can see where the code for the students will appear in order to participate in this interactive task. Please note that Mentimeter codes expire after 48 hours. As mentioned before, all these responses can be saved under your profile in Mentimeter.com. And you can always go back to it whenever you want to either update it or compare this data over time with your students. This slide shows what the students would see from their perspective. To participate, they would have to go to Menti.com and put in the code that is assigned. Once they do this, they will be provided with the question or questions that you have created. They would then need to submit their answers and the application automatically and instantly updates. As mentioned before, this is a fun, engaging, interactive tool to use with your students to find out how much they know about a particular topic. Please pause the video so that you can explore Mentimeter or other online applications that could be used to gather diagnostic evidence regarding students' prior knowledge. Once you have completed your students' diagnostic assessments and reviewed their responses, you will now have a better understanding of how to go about planning your unit. An introduction to climate change will be the next step. In this slide, I talk about what the main difference is between climate and weather. Students need to know that there is a big difference between both these terms. Climate is defined as the average weather of hundreds, thousands, or even millions of years, whereas weather can change hour to hour and is not the same everywhere in the world. National Geographic provides a definition of climate change. According to them, climate change is a long-term alteration of temperature and typical weather patterns in a place. It usually refers specifically to the rise in global temperatures from the mid-20th century to the present. So why is climate change happening? Well, it has to do with something called the greenhouse effect. Because of human activities such as the burning of fossil fuels, coal, oil, and natural gas, greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide and methane are created, which then get released into the atmosphere. These gases trap heat from the sun's rays inside the atmosphere, causing the Earth's average temperature to increase. The rise in the Earth's temperature is called global warming or the greenhouse effect. When I explain this to my students, I usually use this analogy. I tell them to imagine that they're lying in bed with a blanket around them. They're feeling comfortable, cozy, warm, and they love the way they feel. Now, let's say that someone comes and puts 10 big thick blankets around them. How would they feel now? Students will usually say that they would feel nauseous, sick, sweaty, uncomfortable, having a hard time breathing, anxious, and trapped. Then I tell them this is what the greenhouse effect feels like. When a lot of heat gets trapped in the atmosphere, eventually we will all begin to feel like this. Why are we really concerned about climate change? According to National Geographic, the Earth's climate always changes. When this occurs naturally, it takes thousands of years, and its impacts are not sudden or drastic. However, the real concern now is that due to human activities, the rate at which climate change is happening is very fast. Thus, the resulting impacts are sudden, intensive, frequent, and destructive. This is something that we need to be worried about. Now, let's delve deeper into climate change. What are some of the main sources of climate change? There are many factors that are contributing to our climate crisis. However, for this webcast, only three will be explored. First, the burning of fossil fuels. To produce electricity and to operate vehicles, we burn fossil fuels. When we do this, it produces a lot of pollution, such as the exhaust from a vehicle, which in turn gets released into the atmosphere. Secondly, deforestation. This is when forest cover is removed from an area and then the same area gets used to something else, such as agriculture, housing, and industrial development. When trees are removed, more carbon dioxide gets added into the atmosphere, thus trapping more heat and increasing the greenhouse effect. Lastly, agriculture. The cultivation of soil in order to grow crops and livestock in order to provide food, wool, and other products. When this happens, more greenhouse gases such as methane get released into the atmosphere, thus causing global warming and climate change. After providing this introductory content to students, I will provide the opportunity for them to reflect on what other factors can cause an increase in the greenhouse effect. Please pause the video now and consider how you can have a classroom discussion about other potential sources of climate change. This would also be a great time to have your students research some of the different sources of climate change and present their ideas to their peers. For our youngest learners in kindergarten and early primary, reflect on a picture book that you could use as a springboard to initiate discussions on climate change. A picture book that I have found to be particularly helpful is The Story of Climate Change, a first book about how we can help save our planet, by Catherine Barr, who is a Goodreads author, Steve Williams, and Amy Husband, who is the illustrator. This amazing resource combines history with science. It discusses all the changes that have occurred in the Earth's atmosphere since the existence of life. It provides climate information from the time of the dinosaurs until now. After reading this resource, young readers will learn about various sources, impacts, and possible solutions to climate change. The illustrations are also beautiful, colorful, and thought-provoking, as you can see from this slide. Many classroom discussions can be initiated with your students with this wonderful resource. Now that we have investigated some of the possible sources of climate change with our students, we need to discuss the potential impacts of climate change. Although the impact of climate change is profound, in this webcast, only 5 examples will be explored along with resources that may be helpful to use in your classroom. I have used websites from National Geographic, World Wildlife Fund, and the United Nations, just to name a few. The 5 impacts are the increase in sea level, species endangerment and or extinction, pollution, land, air, and water, frequent and intense weather changes, and lastly, an increase in disease outbreaks. Beside each link, I've also included the appropriate grade level. So, if I click the first link for increase in sea level, you can see it's for students in grades 5 to 8, whereas the second link is for intermediate students only. Both articles have keywords that are underlined so that it can be used for classroom discussion and research. Each of these case studies and or articles can be used for classroom discussions. Remember, you know your students best. use differentiated instruction and universal design for learning when preparing your formative tasks. Please pause the video now to explore some of the resources by completing the search in your preferred web browser. Be sure to take time to reflect on which ones you would like to use in your classroom with your students. In the United Nations report, it states, Indigenous peoples are among the first to face the direct consequences of climate change due to their dependence upon and close relationship with the environment and its resources. Climate change exacerbates the difficulties already faced by Indigenous communities, including political and economic marginalization, loss of land and resources, human rights violations, discrimination, and unemployment. According to the Government of Canada, the Indigenous and Northern communities in this country are specifically vulnerable due to factors such as remoteness and inaccessibility, cold climate, aging and inefficient infrastructure, and lastly, a reliance on diesel for generating electricity and space heating. The Human Rights Watch, or the HRW, did a study on climate change and food supply with the Indigenous and Northern communities in Canada. They studied three regions: Yukon, Northern Ontario, and Northwestern BC. In October of 2020, they submitted a 120-page report called My Fear is Losing Everything: The Climate Crisis and First Nations Right to Food in Canada. According to the Human Rights Watch, and I quote, in the three geographic locations studied, residents reported drastic reductions in the quantity of food they are able to harvest, and increased difficulty and danger associated with harvesting food from the land. These changes are being driven in significant part by climate change impacts on wildlife habitat, including changing ice and permafrost conditions, more and increasingly intense wildfires, warming water temperatures, changes in precipitation and water levels, and unpredictable weather. The HRW further reported that climate change is reducing First Nations traditional food sources, driving up the cost of imported alternatives and contributing to a growing problem of food insecurity and related negative health impacts. Canada is warming at more than twice the global rate, and Northern Canada at about three times the global rate. Despite its relatively small population, Canada is still a top 10 greenhouse gas emitter with per capita emissions 3 to 4 times the global average. Please pause the video and consider how you could incorporate the two quotes provided by the HRW. What are some guiding questions you can ask your students regarding this study? What are some activities that you can think of to get your students to investigate the connection between Indigenous communities in Canada and climate change? Please pause the video now to explore some of the resources by completing a search in your preferred web browser. Now that we have talked about potential sources and impacts of climate change with our students, we need to focus on possible solutions as well. We need to encourage our future generations that there is hope and we can do something about this crisis. According to the David Suzuki Foundation, people need to focus on action, individual action. If each person did one, two, or more of the action items seen on this list, then the Earth would be in a much better situation. Some suggestions from the David Suzuki Foundation include asking individuals to switch to renewable energy, having greener commutes such as taking public transit or walking, consuming less and wasting less, becoming better educated with respect to climate change issues, and getting politically active. To get more information, other recommendations from the Suzuki Foundation, please visit the website at davidsuzuki.org. The recommendations from the David Suzuki Foundation also provide an opportunity to inspire a classroom discussion regarding how they might be able to make changes in their personal lives to fight climate change. This could be another type of assessment for learning. Speaking of assessment as learning, I want to share a task that I created that you can do with your students to assess their learning so far. This activity would be recommended for grades 7 and 8 students. I have selected 4 case studies from around the world: Kenya, Bolivia, Indonesia, and Zimbabwe. All these studies were done by the Pembina Institute. You might be wondering who or what this institute is all about. Well, according to its website, this institution is a Canadian corporation which works to reduce the harmful impacts of fossil fuels while supporting the transition to a clean and safe energy system. Each of these case studies that I selected focus on various impacts of climate change. Now, when I click the link for Kenya's case study, you will notice the following. At the top, there is a brief summary of the case study. The article is divided into different sections: the country's context, the problem that exists in the country, a description of the project that the organization is trying to implement in the country, the impacts or results of the project, and finally, the lessons learned from this project. The same format will exist for the other three case studies as well. As you can see, when I click Bolivia's link, you can see the brief summary at the top, the country's context, the problem that exists in the country, a description of the project that is going to be implemented in the country, the impacts or results of the project, and finally, the lessons learned from the project. So what do I want my students to do with these case studies? Well, in pairs or small groups, I would ask them to read the case together and further build their knowledge regarding climate change. The link to these case studies can be found in the lesson resources, linked in the same area as this webcast on the ETFO website. I instructed my students to take notes while they're reading. Providing students with graphic organizer placements can support their note-taking skills. I provided my students with a graphic organizer that looked like this. As you can see, I divided the placemat into specific sections, similar to the format of the case study. There is the history context section, the problem section, the project section, and finally the impacts and lessons learned section. Naturally, based on the needs and interests of your students, you can modify this however you please. Graphic organizers can be provided electronically as a collaborative document, or paper copies can be distributed. Digital collaborative documents allow each of the group members to have access and share the document at the same time, thus revising and editing whatever they want simultaneously. The only thing you would have to do is provide each of the groups their specific links to the placemat activity. Paper copies have advantages too. They allow students to easily connect ideas, make drawings, and can be displayed in the classroom afterwards. This rich activity encourages students to work together as a team. Students can choose to work on one section of the article and not the whole thing, so it does not get too overwhelming for them. Students work together to deepen their understanding of the article. Each small group can present their learning to the class. Using differentiated instruction, I provide the opportunity for students to present their case studies in different ways. For instance, students may choose to present their findings musically in the form of a song, dramatically in the form of a skit, kinesthetically in the form of a model or diorama, and or visually or artistically in the form of a poster. Again, think about the needs, skills, and interests of your students when determining the various tasks. Another online application that I can use for an assessment as learning is Google Jamboard. Remember, please check the application usage policy in your district school board. This application can also be used for diagnostic purposes, but in this case, I'll use it for an assessment as learning, or a formative one. Now, you might be asking, how do I get to Jamboard? Once you have a Google account, from your Google Drive, you can use the Select menu and choose New. A list of different resources will pop up, such as Google Documents, Google Slides, Google Sheets, and so on. But what you would do is to click More. When you do this, you'll notice that more tools, such as Google Drawings, Google My Maps, and Mindomo come up. We want to click on Google Jamboard. Like Mentimeter, Jamboard is an interactive, colorful, and user-friendly application. However, some of the challenges with this tool is that students can change the responses of others, and it can be quite difficult to manage if they don't adhere to the rules of the activity. So like all activities in the classroom, make sure that you explicitly inform your students what the rules are and what the expectations are of the activity in order for it to proceed smoothly. As you can see, on the left side of the frame, there's a bunch of tools or buttons: a pen, an eraser, select, sticky note, add image, circle, text box, and a laser. On the top, you can see how many frames you have and you can also modify the background. You can use this tool to ask questions and or discuss various concepts learned in class with your students. I usually either use a text box or a post-it note to ask a question or make a comment. Then I tell the students what I want them to do with that question or comment. Remember, since this is a Google resource, the tool is interactive so all the students can work on the same frame at the same time. So in this particular example, I've asked my students to provide a piece of information that they have learned regarding climate change. I've also asked them to add an image that relates to their information. To support my students so they know what I'm asking, I also provide them an example of an appropriate response. In this case, I have written that climate change causes an increase in sea level and glaciers melt. I've included my name on the post-it so that everyone else will know who wrote that comment. As requested, I've also provided an image that illustrates the melting of glaciers. At the end of this activity, you hope to have all your students insert something on the frames that show their level of understanding with respect to climate change. As you can see on this slide, this is how the frames would look once all your students submit a response. Naturally, more than one frame would have to be used because not all the submissions will fit on one frame. As mentioned before, Jamboard is a fun, interactive online tool to use with your students. Is very user-friendly, so even students in the primary grades will be able to understand how to use it effectively. It is also a fun way to see what your students have learned with respect to your unit. A lot of the time, my students ask to add more information if they can, because they just like looking for images and copying and pasting them in the frame. The level of engagement and enthusiasm increases a great deal when you ask them to demonstrate their understanding with this tool. Let's summarize the information presented in this webcast so far. We wanted our students to learn about climate change, and we also wanted to focus on how to assess for learning throughout this unit so that we could monitor our students' progress. We started off with a great interactive online tool called Mentimeter that could be used to see how much our students already know about climate change. In other words, it was used as a diagnostic assessment. We then wanted to introduce the term climate change and then delve deeper into the possible sources, impacts, and solutions of climate change. We used references from National Geographic, World Wildlife Fund, David Suzuki Foundation, Pembina Institute, United Nations, Human Rights Watch, and NASA, just to name a few to introduce to our students. Then to ensure that our students were progressing in their understanding of climate change, we divided them into groups and provided them with case studies from around the world. They had to work as a team to understand and present their findings creatively to the rest of their class. Again, in order to meet the needs, skills, and interests of your students, we incorporated differentiated instruction and universal design for learning. Another fun online tool we used to assess the academic progress in our students was Google Jamboard. This tool is so user-friendly that it can be used by students as young as in grade one. You might have noticed that I used various sources in this webcast to demonstrate different concepts of climate change. Some of the sources I used were the David Suzuki Foundation, the Pembina Institute, National Geographic, NASA, the Human Rights Watch, and the World Wildlife Fund, just to name a few. Well, why did I use these sources and not others? It is very important that we use sources that are reliable, accurate, relevant, and current. In fact, there is a criteria that one should use to evaluate our sources. It is called the CRAAP test. Let's delve a little bit into this test, shall we? The C stands for currency, or the timeliness of the research. When was it posted, revised? Are the links functional and updated? The R stands for relevance, the uniqueness of the content and its relevance for my needs. In other words, can I find this content somewhere else? What is the breadth and depth of this content? Does this site provide the information that I want? The first A stands for authority, the source of the information. Who is the author? Has the author published other works? Is he or she credible? The second A is for accuracy. Is the information accurate, truthful, and correct? Is the original information provided? Does the language or tone seem biased? Where does the information come from? And lastly, the P stands for purpose, the presence of bias or prejudice. What is the purpose of this article? To entertain or teach? Are biases clearly stated? For the sources that I used today in the webcast, they all passed the CRAAP tests. They were all relevant, current, accurate, credible, and had purpose. So this brings us to the end of the webcast. We need to let our students know that there is hope, and there are lots of actions we can take to reduce the climate crisis. Please pause the video at this time to read over some of the quotes found in this slide and reflect on how you could use these quotes in your classroom. How would your students feel about these quotes? Would they feel empowered and encouraged, or would they feel anxious and worried? Are your students willing to make changes in their everyday lives to reduce the impact of climate change? And if so, what would they like to do? What changes will you make in your professional practice and in the classroom? Turning off lights when not needed, or having a bin of good on one side paper or goose papers are immediate actions that you and your students can start right away in your classrooms. Thank you for participating in this webcast today. There is a series of lesson plans that accompany this webcast, which can be found in the same area as this webcast on the ETFO website. Please go to etfo.org and click on the Member Resources tab in the navigation bar. From here, you can either select the Webcast to Support Classroom Practice webpage, which has links to this webcast and the accompanying lesson plans, along with webcasts and lessons regarding other topics, or you can select Classroom Resources from the menu on the left-hand side and search climate change for even more ETFO resources to support the integration and learning about climate change in the elementary classroom. I hope the information you heard today will benefit you in your classrooms. Remember, you know your students the best. Try to incorporate differentiated instruction and universal design for learning in your lesson planning. There are many online tools available that you can use with your students in order to increase their level of engagement and enthusiasm with your assigned activities. Ask your students what they would like to learn and see if you can incorporate their interests in your planning. Have them create their own success criteria and assignments. This in turn will encourage student accountability and engagement. As mentioned before, assessments can be innovative, make use of digital tools, and provide opportunities for students to collaborate. Have fun with your teaching and make connections with your students. Remember, they may forget what you said, but they will never forget how you made them feel. Thank you again. Until next time.